Gigi! Gigi!
What?
Wake up! You're late!
Late for what?
Springtime!
Make me breakfast. Ow! My spare eye! Ow!
Spring is a wonderful time of year. It's a time when the snow finally stops after April. It's also a time for animals to come out of hibernation, find a mate, and even have lots of babies. Spring and babies go hand in hand so well, it's practically a cultural cliche. But spring isn't just a good time for animals to come out and start, you know, having babies. It's also a great time for humans like us to do things like barbecuing, going for a hike, cleaning the swimming pool, digging the swimming pool, building the swimming pool, filling the swimming pool, and finally, sitting back, relaxing with a fire, eating some s'mores, and enjoying a nice malt lick. Balls. Some generic, delicious malt balls for that nice spring day.
You alright?
You think I swallowed one?
Should I stop filming?
Number 5.
Our number 5 spot is a very common and recognizable songbird here in the United States. They're the first ones to wake up at the crack of dawn, and they love to sing their pretty song for you at 4:30 in the morning! They're the state bird of Connecticut, Michigan, and Wisconsin. This is the American robin, or Turdus migratorius.
American robins, or Turdus migratorius, are migratory songbirds of the thrush genus Turdidae. They're very distinct as they have dark bodies, yellow beaks, and red chests. Males and females do differ as the females have a paler color palette than the males. Juveniles still have their spots and can fly. They're found year-round from Canada and Alaska all the way down to southern Mexico and Guatemala. They're the most abundant and widespread thrush.
They weigh 2.7 ounces and their wingspan is only 4 to 6 inches. They have a very lovely song which you can recognize in your backyard. It sounds like this. Their song goes, cheer up, cheerily, cheer up, cheerily. Very beautiful.
Robins lay eggs in trees in their nests that they build 5 to 15 feet above the ground. And sometimes they'll even build it in human structures such as roofs, windows, and attics. Females build the nest from the inside out, pressing dead grass and twigs into a cup shape using the wrists of her wings. Once the shape is set, she'll harden it with soft mud and worm castings to make a heavy nest. She'll lay around 4 blue-green eggs, which takes about 14 days to hatch. Sadly though, only 25% of the hatchlings will make it to adulthood.
Robins have a slew of predators. Their eggs will be eaten by squirrels, birds of prey, and snakes. Even blue jays have been known to eat eggs and hatchlings. Hatchlings also get eaten by other birds such as grackles, crows, and ravens. Adult robins can get eaten by cats, larger snakes, and birds of prey. A very lucky robin can live to be 14 years old, but the average American robin lives to be about 2 to 6.
If you want to see robins in your yard and spruce up your window view, well, you're in luck because robins are very common. All you'll need to do is get an average birdhouse that has protection from predators and a simple bird feeder that is high above ground and away from land predators. You can also place fruit, peanuts, mealworms, and spindles on it as well. You'll have lovely singing friends in your yard in no time. I left a link in the description below. Number 4.
Our number 4 spot is also a very common sight in the spring. They're Canada's gift to us, although we've been looking for the receipt ever since. Thanks, Canada. They're found in every single US state and Canadian province. They're kind of really mean, and they're considered a pest in some communities. This is our number 4 spot, the Canadian geese. Canada goose, or Bronta canadensis, is a very large species of goose that is very successful in living and adapting in human communities. They have a black head and neck with a white chin strap and a brown and white body. They travel in flocks and are very famous for their loud honking noises too. They're even famous for traveling south for the winter, but sometimes south could mean Southern Canada or even the Northern United States. Some flocks don't even migrate at all if the food is plentiful and the weather is fair. They stand about 3 feet tall, and some even have a 6-foot wingspan.
These geese have been considered a nuisance. They flock around human parks and civilizations so much that they destroy the area at times. They leave droppings everywhere, they harass anyone that comes near them, and they'll even steal food, hiss at everyone, and when they have babies, they can attack people who they see are too close. This is all by experience, by the way. Geese have been known to destroy crops, block vehicle traffic, and chase after humans and other animals. They're such sweethearts, aren't they? Geese love to eat freshly cut grass, any type of grass, water plants, insects, fish, nuts, berries, algae, seeds, roots, and other varieties of plants. If food gets very low for them, they can go 30 days without eating. Geese also have a slew of predators. They are federally protected under the United States, and they or their eggs cannot be harmed unless given permission by the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service. Their wild predators, however, are coyotes, foxes, bears, dogs, skunks, crows, ravens, raccoons, and much more. A goose's lifespan is 10 to 24 years in the wild, but in managed care, they can live to be 30 to 35. Some sources say they can live to be 80.
Geese will mate for life. When they do find that special someone, they will mate between April and May. They'll lay 2 to 10 eggs per clutch, and the female will build the nest made out of grasses, leaves, twigs, branches, and sometimes even human refuse. After about 28 to 30 days, the eggs will hatch, and then after 24 hours, the parents will bring them down to the water for their first swimming lessons. Goslings can dive 30 to 40 feet underwater. Geese are often seen flying in the famous V formation. This formation is known as a wedge or a skein. The geese will fly with the wind, and the goose at the head of the wedge is interchanged often because this is the most energy taxing position. A formation like that allows the geese to fly 1,500 miles in 24 hours. Now, do you remember that sound from earlier? They'll make that sound while flying, and scientists have different theories about why they do that. The most common being that they're encouraging the head goose to go ahead and do his best, while other theories suggest that it's a form of communication or it's a way to pass the time while flying.
Number 3.
Our number 3 spot has been domesticated for thousands of years. Their wool has been used in clothing for almost just as long. Little Bo Peep lost them, Mary had one, and yes sir, 3 bags full. This is the domesticated sheep, or Ovis aries aries.
Sheep were domesticated from wild sheep around 5,000 BC or 9 to 11,000 years ago. Their remains have been found at many sites that also included human habitation. The Middle East, Europe, and Central Asia were among those digs. Domesticated sheep have been used for their wool, meat, and milk. Sheep meat is called mutton, and lamb meat is just called lamb. There is estimated to be more than 1 billion sheep in the world, and the most common sheep countries are New Zealand, Australia, Scotland, China, the US, South Africa, Argentina, Turkey, and many more. Matter of fact, New Zealand, Australia, and Scotland, and Mongolia, and many more countries have more sheep than they have people.
They have poor depth perception, but holy sheep, they have amazing peripheral vision. Without turning their heads, sheep can see 300 degrees around them. For comparison, humans can only see 155 degrees without moving their heads. This is mostly due to what sheep have known as bar pupils. As prey animals to many, including wolves, coyotes, bears, wildcats, and much, much more, they need to depend highly on sight and sound. They have very little defenses for protecting themselves, but they do have safety in numbers. Have you heard of the phrase, like a lamb to the slaughter, mindless like a sheep, wake up sheeple? Well, believe it or not, just like pigs, sheep are very intelligent. Matter of fact, a 2001 study by Keith Kendrick of the University of Electronic Science and Technology in China, where most of the population of sheep live, found that sheep can remember up to 200 faces for over 2 years. I can't even remember what color my coffee barista's hair was this morning. They can solve and navigate complex mazes, and it was found that hearing and seeing their fellow sheep at the finish line motivated them to reach the exit. Sheep are very intelligent. They have complex emotions. They'll make friends and even stick up for each other when they get into a fight.
Sheep are used for many things, including wool. Wool in domestic sheep is very popular, and you might have some in your dresser drawers right now. To take the wool off of a sheep is called shearing. The person doing it is called a shearer. They use special tools and proper care of the sheep when trimming. They are usually sheared prior to the warmer months or depending on the climate and availability of the shears. Well, domestic sheep need to be sheared. It's great for their health. Unlike wild sheep, which shed naturally, domestic sheep wool keeps growing and growing and growing. One famous case of a very shaggy sheep was a sheep named Shrek. Shrek wandered off in a cave in Terrace, New Zealand. He lived in that cave for 6 years, and when he was finally caught and came back, he was buried in all that wool. Just look at him. Well, he was sheared on national television, and it took 20 minutes. For comparison, it takes a professional shearer 2 to 3 minutes to shear a normal woolly sheep. Shrek's wool produced enough to make 20 large men's suits and weighed 60 pounds. Shrek became a national icon until his death in 2011 at the ripe old age of 16.
If a sheep were to be rolled over on their back, make sure you either lend a hand, tell a farmer, or a shepherd. A turned over sheep, or a cast sheep, has a hard time turning themselves over either because they're very woolly or very pregnant. A cast sheep is in a lot of trouble because they can literally die from the stress it presents if they're not being preyed on by predators.
Number 2.
Our number 2 spot
is fluttering their way onto our list. They've been flapping around for 34 million years, and they're found on every single continent except Antarctica. This is the butterfly, or Rhopalocera.
Butterflies are insects that are in the order Lepidoptera, which also include moths. Butterflies have 2 sets of wings that allow them to fly. Their wings are made out of a protein called chitin, which makes up the outer shell. They beat their wings in a figure-8 motion, and their wings are so delicate that the slightest touch can cause them to rip or tear. So remember, you can look, but never touch. Maybe a butterfly will land on you. In some places, that's considered good luck. There are 17,500 known species of butterflies in the world. They live on every continent aside from Antarctica, and they range from being 12 inches long to only 0.12 inches long.
Butterflies are super famous for their metamorphosis. When they hatch as caterpillars, they will first eat their eggshell, and then they'll eat the leaves of the plants that they've been laid on. If there's enough caterpillars on a plant, you can actually hear them all munching. The caterpillar will eat those leaves, and then he'll get nice and fat, and a hormone level known as a juvenile hormone will drop to an all-time low, and that's when the caterpillar knows that it's time to move on to the next phase. They'll form a hardened shell around themselves known as a chrysalis.
But Kiki, I thought it was called a cocoon.
Well, my hypothetical friend, a chrysalis is a cocoon for caterpillars, where a cocoon is a cocoon for moth caterpillars. Caterpillars will form that chrysalis around themselves, and then days, months, and in some species, even years later, they'll emerge as a beautiful butterfly.
The most famous butterfly, the monarch, or Danis plexippus, ranged from northern, central, and southern America, Australia, New Zealand, islands in the Atlantic, islands in the Pacific, and a bit of Europe. Well, in the Americas, they travel farther than any other butterfly. They'll travel 3,000 miles. Monarchs born in late summer or early fall will make the one-way trip from California to Mexico. By the time the next year's winter trip begins, many summer generations will have lived and died. It will be the great-grandchildren of the previous migrators who will make the trip. This new generation will make the same trip as their ancestors, follow the same route, and sometimes even return to the same tree. Monarchs also have the longest lifespan, which is 9 to 12 months long.
Butterflies have developed many techniques to hide from predators. One of which is known as cryptic coloration, where they can blend in perfectly with leaves and the barks of other trees. Another technique is chemical warfare, where butterflies will be very brightly colored because predators know that those butterflies have a mix of toxic chemicals in them and are very, very poisonous. Predators learned over a very long time not to mess with animals that are very brightly colored like that. This technique is known as aposematism.
Sadly though, due to elements such as climate change, pesticides, and deforestation, many butterfly species are endangered. But you can help butterflies every spring by doing things like putting out a butterfly spa, which is sunny flat rocks next to a shallow pool of water, plant milkweed and other butterfly flowers such as native plants which are reds, yellows, oranges, pinks, and purples. If you want a beautiful butterfly garden, I left a link below to help you get started. And number one.
Our number one spot is the most popular of springtime animals. They're in every single continent except for Antarctica, and they're used for many centuries for food, companionship, and even many forms of media and art. This is the common rabbit, or caniculus.
Rabbits were once included in the order Rodentia as they had elongated teeth that constantly grew. But in 1912, they were moved from the order Rodentia to their own order, which was Lagomorpha. This order includes rabbits, hares, and pikas. Now, the difference between rabbits and hares is that hares are longer. They have longer, more elongated ears, and hares have never been domesticated, whereas the descendant of the European rabbit have been domesticated for thousands of years as a companionship animal and as a livestock animal.
Rabbits, depending on the species, can grow from 8 inches with the pygmy rabbits or as large as 16 pounds as with the Flemish giant. But the ones you see in your backyard, such as the Eastern Cottontail, only weighs 1.8 to 4.4 pounds. Eastern Cottontails are the most widespread of the rabbit species in North America and can even be seen in Northern South America as well. They make nests mostly in your backyard and leave their babies alone for hours to days at a time while they're out finding food. If you do find some baby rabbits or kits in your backyard, please don't disturb them. But if you do have to move them, I left a link in the description below that will help you get these babies to safety. Rabbits are a very ubiquitous species and they're very important to a number of predators. They're preyed on by everything from birds of prey, mammalian predators, and even predators of the waters too. Their long legs are evolutionary adaptations that help them escape all creatures of the world that want to eat them. With all the predators that hunt them, how do rabbits survive so well? Well, for one, they have a lot of babies. They can produce 1 to 7 litters per year, with around 5 to 12 babies per litter. This is also mixed with the fact that humans have chased away most of the rabbit predators with the development of civilizations. Most rabbits find safety near human habitats. The average lifespan for a rabbit in the wild is 3 years, but a lucky wild rabbit can live to around 5. The life of one in managed care can be around 9.
Rabbit ancestors have been traced back to around 35 million years ago, where they diverged into 3 different groups: rabbits, hares, and pikas. The European rabbit ancestor evolved sometime around 4,000 years ago on the Iberian Peninsula. After that, they spread like wildfire and bred like, well, you know. They dispersed so much and so far that they covered the entire world, and many pop culture icons and religious cultures were based around these rabbits. You might know a lot of famous rabbits such as Bugs Bunny, Peter Cottontail, the Easter Bunny, Br'er Rabbit, El Herrera and the Rabbits of Watership Down, Frank, the White Rabbit from Alice in Wonderland, too many religious rabbits such as the Moon Rabbit of India, China, and Japan, Nana Bozo, the rabbit god of many Native American tribes, and even many hybrid creatures such as the jackalope and the wolpertinker.
Pet rabbits are a lot of fun, but they do require a bit of work. They love to stretch, so make sure your bunny is let out so they can run around and have fun. Don't get a pet rabbit unless you have done your required research and have the required supplies. Talk to a rabbit caretaker to see what you need to bring a new friend home. When rabbits are happy and excited, they'll hop in the air and twist in an action known as a binky.
Rabbits, when angry or threatened, will lash out with their front legs, so make sure you keep your pet rabbits happy. But cornered wild rabbits will fight, and these fights have left many predators running. Some fights have even ended with predators being blinded.
Well, I'm so glad that we got to learn about 5 springtime facts about 5 springtime animals. If you learned something today or you want to learn more, make sure you like, comment, and subscribe. Also, if you want to help support us, you can also join us on Instagram, Twitter, Patreon, or Facebook. Now, make sure you share this video so that way your friends can also learn about awesome animals as well. So, we'll definitely see you next time. It's 5 o'clock and this zoo is closing and we're going to get kicked out here pretty soon. So, we'll see you next time here at Kiki's Fun Animal Countdown. Bye.